Spring song is page 36 in Joyful Noise, I Love You, Lord. So let's sing this one twice, please. And see the love God has given to us.
Come and see what it means to be children of God.
Come with this hope that Christ's presence is real.
With joy we come to see the Lord.
Our opening hymn is page 242 in your hymnal, Come All You Servants of the Lord.
One. We are stunned by the miracles of new life and forgiveness you offer.
When our awe turns to disbelief, renew us with your joy.
When our stumbling leads us to sin, forgive us by your grace
and direct our steps in your paths of righteousness.
In Christ's name we pray.
Amen. And we are blessed in the knowledge that God has forgiven our sins, and we all are pardoned. I had to wing that one because I forgot to look that up.
Glory be to the Father.
A joyful time in our worship service when we pass the peace to one another.
Thank you for coming. Jesus Christ be with you.
And with you.
Peace be with you.
Good to see you.
Good to see you.
The hymn listed in the bulletin is the wrong page number.
Yes.
It's page 8 in your praise song book, Thy Word. Join me, please, in the prayer for illumination. Eternal God, your kingdom has broken into our troubled world through the life, death, and resurrection of your Son. Help us hear your word and obey it, that we may become instruments of your saving love through Jesus Christ our Lord.
First reading is James 2, verses 14 through 17. And I'm going to read from the New King James Version. What does it profit, my brethren, If someone says he has faith but does not have works, can faith save him? If a brother or sister is naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you says to them, depart in peace, be warm and filled, but you do not give them the things which is needed for the body, what does it profit? Thus also faith by itself, if it does not have works, it is dead. The next is Matthew 25, verses 34 through 40. Then the king will say to those in his right hand, come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you took me in. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me. Then the righteous will answer him, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and we gave you drink? When did we see you in a stranger and take you in, or naked or clothe you? Or when did we see you sick or in prison or come to you? And the king will answer to say them, assuredly, I say to you, inasmuch as you did it to one of the least of these, my brethren, you did it to me. So be the word of the Lord. Amen.
Thanks be to God. It'll take me just a minute. I noticed that Nancy needs a lot more. Stand on that. A lot more help being seen than I do. So, you know, I started thinking about the theme for today, and there were suggestions, but I was reading in the Sacred Encounters that we're doing in the Women's Bible Study, and I read the prayer by Teresa of Avila. Now, it's written, she was on this earth between 1550 and 1582. So even though she's been gone a long time, her words are really apropos with what I wanted to talk about today. No hands but ours. It's on page 17 if you want to check it out in your copy. Christ has no body now on earth but yours. No hands, but no feet but yours. Yours are the eyes through which the compassion of Christ must look out on the world. Yours are the feet with which God is to go about doing good. Yours are the hands with which God is to bless his people. James chapter 1, verse 22 states that God wants us to be doers of the word and not hearers only. As in today's verse, James chapter 2, verse 14 through 17, it specifies what we must do to follow this guidance. Mere wishes for peace and warmth and food, yet providing nothing toward these needs, is not enough. Faith without work solves nothing. If we are taking time every day to glorify God and serve others, then our faith is probably in a good place. There are many ways in which our First Presbyterian Church of Corona follows these directions. We give out bags with water and food. We greet each other with love and compassion. We support outreach through offerings such as One Great Hour of Sharing. We give rides to those in need of transportation. We share food and fellowship to create a church family where isolation is dispersed. And there are many other things I know that we do here that I'm not totally aware of. I haven't spent enough time reading about the global missions, etc. But this church really tries to do good works as well as speaking good works. There are things that we can do in our every lives to exhibit Christ's love and forgiveness and compassion. Our experiences vary, and we face struggles within our families and jobs and neighborhoods. When we know someone facing difficulties, we are likely to empathize with them. My experiences, because my mother was afflicted with bipolar disorder,
made me sensitive and aware of the lack of understanding in our society for those with mental illness. And I became more compassionate when I saw people afflicted by it. In my neighborhood, as my children were growing up, I came to know several young boys who were LGBTQ, although I didn't recognize it at first. But they struggled. One boy, he tried to change himself. He tried to date girls, and he just never felt right. They all struggled in different ways, but they're all children of a loving God. If we are to be Christ's eyes and ears and hands and feet, then we must love them too. Homelessness is a major problem in Southern California and many parts of the country. We should support ways that provide homes and services for so many in need. I've seen firsthand what happens to children when their families lose housing. I tutored and read to children in a homeless shelter here in Corona. There were twin boys who entered the shelter with nice clothing and who seemed well adjusted. But over the next year, they changed dramatically. One became weepy and afraid of everything. The other boy became aggressive and started fighting with other children because their lives were so changed by not having a home. Their parents worked, but they didn't have the money to, I guess they were evicted. Anyway, both these boys needed constant reassurance and comfort. They both needed shelter and warmth and love. So what can we do individually? I found some stories and poems and quotes in the book Chicken Soup for the Woman's Soul by Jack Canfield, Mark Vidor Hansen, Jennifer Reed Hawthorne, and Marcy Shima. It contains some very good ideas along these lines. And the first is entitled, Are You God? One cold evening during the holiday season, a little boy about 6 or 7 was standing out in front of a store window. The little child had no shoes and his clothes were mere rags. A young woman passing by saw the little boy and could read the longing in his eyes. She took the child by the hand and led him into the store. There she bought him some new shoes and a complete set of warm clothing. They came back outside into the street and the woman said to the child, Now you can go home and have a very happy holiday. The little boy looked up at her and asked, Are you God, ma'am? She smiled down at him and replied, No, son, I'm just one of his children. The little boy then said, I knew you had to be some relation. The second vignette is called No Small Act of Kindness. The day was Thankful Thursday, our designated day of service. It's a weekly tradition that my two little girls and I began years ago. Thursday has become our day to go out into the world and make a positive contribution. On this particular Thursday, we had no idea exactly what we were going to do, but we knew that something would present itself. Driving along a busy Houston road, praying for guidance in our quest to fulfill our weekly act of kindness, the noon hour appropriately triggered hunger pangs in my two little ones. They wasted no time in letting me know, chanting, McDonald's, 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 as we drove along. I relented and began searching earnestly for the nearest McDonald's. Suddenly, I realized that almost every intersection I passed through was occupied by a panhandler. And then it hit me. If my two little girls were hungry, then all those panhandlers must be hungry too. Perfect. Our act of kindness was presented to us. We were going to buy lunch for the panhandlers. After finding a McDonald's and ordering 2 Happy Meals for my girls, I ordered an additional 15 lunches, and we set out to deliver them. It was exhilarating. We would pull alongside a panhandler, make a contribution, and tell him or her that we hope things got better. And then we would say, oh, by the way, here's lunch. And then we would vroom off to the next intersection. It was the best way to give, There wasn't enough time for us to introduce ourselves or explain that we were going what we were going to do, nor was there time for them to say anything back to us. The act of kindness was anonymous and empowering for each of us, and we loved what we saw in the rearview mirror, a surprised and delighted person holding up his lunch bag and just looking at us as we drove off. It was wonderful. We had come to the end of our route, and there was a small woman standing there asking for change. We handed her our final contribution and lunch bag, and then immediately made a U-turn to head back in the opposite direction for home. Unfortunately, the light caught us again, and we were stopped at the same intersection where this little woman stood. I was embarrassed and didn't know quite how to behave. I didn't want her to feel obligated to say or do anything. She made her way to our car, so I put the window down as she started to speak. "No one has ever done anything like this for me before," she said with amazement. I replied, "Well, I'm glad that we were the first." Feeling uneasy and wanting to move the conversation along, I asked, "So when do you think you'll eat your lunch?" She just looked at me with her huge, tired brown eyes and said, "Oh, honey, I'm not going to eat this lunch." I was confused, but before I could say anything, she continued, "You see, I have a little girl of my own at home, and she just loves McDonald's. But I can never buy it for her because I just don't have the money. But you know what? Tonight she is going to have McDonald's." I don't know if the kids noticed the tears in my eyes. So many times I had questioned whether our acts of kindness were too small or insignificant to really affect change. Yet in that moment, I recognized the truth of Mother Teresa's words. "We cannot do great things, only small things with great love." And Emily Dickinson is one of my favorite poets. And she writes very small verses, but with great meaning. And speaking of acts of kindness, she said, "If I can stop one heart from breaking, I shall not live in vain. If I can ease one life the aching, or cool one pain, or help one fainting robin onto its nest again, I shall not live in vain." And so each of us, in our own way, can smile, can help others. And I have a few suggestions. They're very lighthearted suggestions called "It Couldn't Hurt." For random acts of kindness, it couldn't hurt. "I told my husband I love him. Couldn't hurt. I packed a note in my son's lunchbox telling him how special he is. Couldn't hurt. I opened the door for a lady in the wheelchair at Walgreens. Couldn't hurt. I left a box of cookies for the mailman. Couldn't hurt. I let someone go in front of me in the grocery line. It didn't hurt. I called my brother to tell him I miss him. He misses me too. I sent the mayor a note saying what a good job he is doing. Couldn't hurt. I took flowers to the nursing home. Couldn't hurt. I thanked the person who bagged my groceries. He beamed. I gave my assistant the day off with pay. It only hurt a little. I played ball with my dog. It felt good. I invited a woman who doesn't drive to lunch and to a movie. It felt marvelous. Random acts of kindness. Maybe I'll live this way all year. It couldn't hurt. So, therefore, we too can show our love and compassion in everyday situations. I'm sure you've already experienced some of those things. Opened the door for somebody who couldn't get in. Smiled at somebody who did a favor for you and had them and thanked them. I know when my children were at Letha Rainey, they had a couple of wonderful teachers. And I wrote notes to those teachers saying, "You've done a wonderful job. My children are so excited about what they're learning in class. Thank you." And as a teacher, when I received thank yous from parents or from my students, it thrilled me because you realize you're making a difference. And all of us can make a difference. Some of us do it through beautiful music. And some of us do it through providing food for people here. And some of us do it through every day when they're working with difficult children in public schools or in private schools. But we can forgive others when we've been hurt, and all of us get hurt sometimes. We can forgive others when we feel that their opinions are not the right ones, or maybe we forgive ourselves for holding them so dearly. We can perform a myriad of random acts of kindness. God's love and compassion are all-inclusive. Our role is to be His hands to feed the hungry, to give drink to the thirsty, to clothe the naked, to welcome the stranger, and above all, to forgive others and sometimes forgive ourselves. It is so easy to judge others by their appearance. We need to focus on finding the good in everyone. According to Galatians 5, verses 22 and 23, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Isn't that what we wish to find for ourselves, for our families, for our neighbors, and for our world? May God bless us in the days ahead. Thank you.
Please stand and join me in the proclamation of faith, which is the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Jesus Christ, who for us and our salvation was crucified and buried. He arose the third day and ascended into heaven. His kingdom shall have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. I believe in one holy universal church, acknowledging one baptism for the remission of sins. And I look for the resurrection of the dead.
Amen.
It is now time to share our joys and concerns.